I left it when I was 2.
Oh, clear.
So, yeah.
You don't remember anything.
So I don't remember anything from my youth, but when I did come back when I was in seventh grade, I have a lot of fond memories.
Okay. Yeah. Now, when you come back, I know very well that you came in this morning?
Yeah.
This morning.
Yeah, yeah.
What has it been like?
Amazing. Yeah. Incredible. There was a band out playing, you know, everybody's out singing.
You were not expecting that.
No, not at all. Yeah. Not at all. Even when I got off the plane, there was people, cameras and media everywhere waiting for me to get off the plane.
Yeah.
So it's just been...
Well, you're a superstar. You expected
that. Yeah, well, I suppose. But at the end of the day, I'm just a guy who followed his dream. Mm. And it's still very heartwarming that people would receive me so well, and I'm just grateful for that.
Let's talk about that dream.
Yeah.
This has always been your dream?
Always. People have a lot of moments where they can think, like, hey, I became a wrestling fan when I saw this match. For me, I feel like I've always been a wrestling fan. I used to watch guys like Ricky Steamboat, you know, Shawn Michaels, all those guys.
Love John Cena.
John Cena, too. Yeah, there you go. He used to be my neighbor, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah, we lived in Tampa.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, another, you know, these are guys who I was just always attracted to the glamour.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was something where you could see people doing athletic things. You could see fireworks. Ricky the Dragon Steamboat, who I mentioned earlier, used mm-hmm. to come out blowing fire. So I couldn't help but be attracted to this spectacle. You know,
mm-hmm.
it's always been my dream. And I would tell people that I wanted to be a WWE superstar when I was in high school.
And what was their reaction?
They would always say that I was too small because,
right.
you know, I was like 100 pounds. You see the WWE superstars, they're like...
They're huge.
6'5",
yeah.
you know, 300 pounds,
yeah.
and I, even now I'm not that, you know, but I didn't let those doubts stop me from pursuing this dream, and I'm glad that I didn't, because
yeah.
here I am.
And your family accepted when you told your parents that you wanted to go into wrestling, they accepted it?
Eventually, yes.
It was difficult in the beginning.
It was a little bit, yeah, because they didn't really know how big it was going to be. I
right.
remember when I first told my mom that I was going to start wrestling, she was like, oh, because I just graduated from college,
mm.
and they put all this money in for me to graduate from college, and now I'm saying I want to go do something else that didn't involve my degree. But my mom was just like, well, make sure to keep climbing that corporate ladder and keep on, you know,
yeah.
working towards. But now she's my biggest fan, you
yeah.
know, my dad.
You never got into corporate at all?
No, I was. I was involved. So out of high school, I mean, out of college, I graduated with a degree in communications. And I was working in the corporate world. Actually, so Staples is an office supply superstore.
Mm-hmm.
Their corporate headquarters is outside of Boston, where I
right.
used to live. And I was working with the advertising team there. And then I twist over to the merchandising team. But I just wasn't fulfilled. Sitting
right.
in a cubicle all day works for some people. But for me, I needed, you know, even like having an interview out
you
here outside. I want to be doing something that didn't involve just like sitting here all day.
Right.
It's not me,
yeah.
you know. So I decided to pursue my dream, and it worked.
And here you are.
Here I am.
A champion.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that particular competition
yeah.
that saw you become the new world champion.
Yeah.
Take us through the preparation mentally and physically before
yeah.
then.
So even, from a broader perspective, I had never had a match that involved competing for the WWE Championship. I first debuted on TV in January of 2008.
Right.
So over 11 years of never having a match to compete for this. You know, finally I was getting that chance, and finally it was going to be at WrestleMania, the grandest stage of them all. You know, 85,000 people come from all over the world to watch live at MetLife Stadium in New York. The feeling was just incredible because at a certain point in time, the people wanted me to win as badly as I did. So
right.
they are the ones who fueled this whole movement. I ended up getting this position because somebody got hurt, and I was able to fill in for them.
Right.
And then the people just, you know, they followed me, and they wanted it, and they cheered it at the arenas, and they were just behind me even now. So I owe a lot to the fans, because without them, if they didn't demand this, I don't know if this happens. But
mm-hmm.
yeah, WrestleMania was crazy. 85,000 people there.
Was that the biggest crowd for you yet?
In the ballpark, I think a couple years ago, maybe there was like 90-something thousand. But
right.
for me personally, having to wrestle at WrestleMania by myself in a singles match for the WWE Championship, that was my childhood dream. So
mm-hmm.
it was easily the biggest moment of my career.
Mm-hmm.
And then being able to win, just,
yeah.
it's history making.
Yeah. I mean, the part that I love about wrestling is when the opponent or one of them just finally goes down.
Yeah.
The moment between the time they start the wrestling and the time they go down, I can't watch it. It's scary for me. And there are a few people like that who think that wrestling is such an aggressive sport.
Sure.
And it's dangerous. Is it dangerous?
Well, it's dangerous in the sense that you don't want to do what we do in the ring. We are very, you know, we train for years and years to perfect what we do. You definitely don't want to try this at home because you will get hurt. We tell that to people all the time. But from an entertainment aspect, we are able to, you know, go year-round because we are so entertaining. If you look out in our crowd, you'll see mothers and their daughters and, you know, sons and just families. It's a family-oriented event, and we pride ourselves on being able to provide a show that you can bring the whole family to.
Right.
So it is something that is not just for one demographic of people. You look at our crowd and you see people from all different backgrounds, all different types of walks of life, and they all come to be entertained. We provide that for
them. So what do you tell people who really want to follow the sport, but they feel that there's too much danger associated with it, so it's actually stopping them from falling in love with the sport?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's a lot more than just wrestling. It's about storytelling. Since the beginning of time, cavemen used to sit around fires and tell stories, and that's really what we do, is we tell stories in the ring. When you see somebody like me and Daniel Bryan, for example, we had the match at WrestleMania for this WWE Championship 2 years before. Daniel Bryan was in the same position that I was in,
right,
where everybody was demanding that he, you know, be in WrestleMania and have this title match. And now 2 years later, he's on the other end as the bad guy who's trying, you know, he's calling me all the names that people used to call him. So now if you're watching and you're following from a storyline perspective like that, it's just a perfect story, you know.
Right.
So that's what we tell people, is that if you like having stories told to you, and you like listening to stories, and you like to be entertained, then you're going to like the WWE shows.
Is it true that it's staged?
Yeah, it's an entertainment. It's entertainment, you know, just like any other TV show. WWE, and I've been saying this over the last few interviews that I've been in, the most important letter in that acronym is that E, that entertainment aspect.
Okay.
We know the outcomes are predetermined, but we guarantee that you come out and you see a great show every single time, and that's what the beauty behind that is. We can get people to kind of suspend their disbelief and get lost in the moment, the same way you would with any dramatic television show when you fall in love with your characters. We have so many different people from different backgrounds and different characters on our show that, you know, there's something for everybody. There's somebody
and
that you can identify with.
That's why you prefer to be called WWE superstars and not wrestlers.
Yeah, we're a lot more than just wrestlers. We do a lot more than wrestling, even from a community service aspect. We go to children's hospitals and do those visits. We do what's called the Be a Star campaign, where we stand up against bullying. We teach kids to show tolerance and respect for each other, for each other's differences. We do a lot more than just wrestling. When I was a kid, I thought it was just being in the ring and going out and having matches, and now as an adult and a WWE superstar, that's a very, very small part of what we do.
Okay. Now, you've come to Ghana. This is your second time in a while. But it is not such a popular sport in Ghana.
Sure.
Of course, you find people watching WrestleMania, maybe in the minority. Do you have any plans of bringing WWE here, look, to get young people to show some interest in
wrestling? I don't know if there's anything officially planned, but the way things are going, WWE right now, like, it's almost like we're trying to take over the world. You know, we're bigger internationally now than we've ever been. We've had shows in South Africa, Egypt, the Middle East, you know, pretty much all over the world. I think it's just a matter of time before we actually have a show in Ghana. And I've been keeping my fingers crossed for that. But even coming here, you see the fandom. You see the people who really are enthralled with our product. So, like I said, I think it's just a matter of time before we are here. And